The title of my message this morning is Ready or Not, Here He Comes.
Good.
All right, if you'll turn with me, if you have a Bible, if not, I'm sure Sandy will put us up on the screen. Matthew chapter 25. Praise God. All right, well, what we're going to do is we're going to actually read the parable of the wise and unwise virgins, and then we're going to break it down. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just give you glory and honor this morning, Lord. We thank you for your precious word, Lord. Your word brings life and truth, oh Lord God. Your word brings illumination, Lord. It gives us light in the midst of darkness so that we can see, Lord, not see physically, Lord, but see spiritually. You're trying to prepare the hearts, Lord God, of believers to they might be able to see spiritually, Lord God, and that they might be aware and prepared, Lord God, for your return. We give you glory and honor this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Matthew chapter 25, starting in verse 1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, that's an old King James word, meaning he waited, he didn't come back right away, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go you out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Amen. So here we have a parable about these 10 virgins. And we've been told that 5 were wise and 5 were unwise. Now I have to tell you that the literal interpretation of this passage of Scripture is based upon the Jewish wedding. And for you and I who aren't Jewish and have never partaken in a Jewish wedding, it makes it very difficult for us to understand completely what's being spoken here. Now, I will tell you also that there's an Old Testament passage called the Song of Solomon that in a similar fashion has much of the same elements as this particular story here. In the Song of Solomon, once again, the literal interpretation is that there is a literal Jewish wedding that's going to be taking place. At the same time, there's a spiritual, a deeper level meaning that's taking place. A spiritual meaning that describes some of the characters in the story. For instance, the bridegroom is representative of Jesus. Amen. Now, in the Old Testament, the Jewish people, even still, they read the Song of Solomon around the time of Passover. And if any of you that know what the Passover was, that was the time whenever God delivered his children Israel out of Egyptian bondage. If you'll remember the story, now I'm just going to go ahead and y'all bear with me. If you've heard it multiple times, just bear with me. But in that story, the children of Israel, God had promised them that there would be a great nation. But in Egypt, which is a type of the world, what are you trying to say? I'm trying to say that there's God's people and then there's worldly people. Amen. Now, you if you're misunderstanding and you're thinking, well, preacher, you're a hypocrite. Preacher, you're looking down on me that or people that are in the world. You're wrong. I used to be in the world. The difference between Christians and those that are in the world is that Christians are those that have heard the truth of the gospel and have responded through faith to what the gospel said. And essentially what the gospel said was this, that mankind born of Adam is born in sin. He has received a sinful nature from his father Adam, and therefore he requires redemption. What is redemption? A purchase must be made. God's plan was that he would create a nation called Israel through which he would give Messiah, who was the sinless one, and the sinless one would purchase back, if you let me say it already like this, a bride to marry the son, hallelujah, but also to purchase him out of his sin. And just as Israel were slaves in Egypt, a type of the world under the bondage of Pharaoh, flavor or a type of the enemy of your soul. Hallelujah. God, Jesus, the Lamb. See, because on Passover night, a lamb had to be slain. A lamb without blemish, a lamb without spot. It had to be inspected. It had to be flayed open. It had to be looked within. It couldn't have tumors. It couldn't have any blemishes on the outside. All this representative of the day when Jesus would come 1,500 years or so later and offer his sinless life on the cross in payment as a purchase price for a bride, for those that are bound in sin, born in sin of Adam. We're all in the same boat, folks.
Amen.
We're all in the same boat, born of Adam, but hallelujah, we can get in another boat, amen, because God is providing a way of salvation.
Hallelujah.
And here Israel is in this bondage as slaves in captivity. See, sometimes people think that they're having fun when they're in the world, but the reality of it is, if truth be told, they're not really having fun. They become a slave to the system of the world.
Amen.
And believe me, if anybody can talk about slavery, I sure have a right to talk about slavery. Because I was a slave to sin. But hallelujah, the blood of Jesus was a purchase price that delivered me out. Did it happen overnight? Absolutely not. It took time to even begin to really properly believe and to trust in what God was doing and in what God was saying. The children of Israel, once again, in captivity, God delivered them out. And so the Song of Solomon, for whatever the reason, and I think that I can see some meaning in the story itself, is read still by the Jewish people around the time of Passover. But ultimately, the literal interpretation of the Song of Solomon describes a marriage again, a marriage of King Solomon to a bride known as the Shulamite woman. I'm not going to get into that too deep right now, but what I want you to know is that there's a literal marriage taking place in both of these stories, but once again, an underlying spiritual meaning in both of them. That God, there's a common theme, and I've preached this on many occasions, a common theme that moves through the scriptures of various ways, like whether it be harvest, but also a wedding. So we see this common theme that takes place in the Old Testament and many times in the New Testament through the parables, that God is preparing a wedding. And the wedding is that God desires to have a bride, and that the bride is you and I, the people of God. See, with that, in the Old Testament, God repeatedly spoke about the fact that Israel was his bride, that he was a husband unto them. Now, unfortunately, Israel went the wrong way, and many times the prophets were told by God to tell the people of Israel that they were behaving like prostitutes, they were behaving like adulteresses. I'm just telling you what the Word of God says. Don't get mad at the preacher. And repeatedly that type of thing, because they were not faithful to the God of Israel that had created them, had purchased them, had married them, if you will. That's how he saw his relationship, because the marriage bed is supposed to be undefiled. Amen. The marriage bed is supposed to be one of purity, and God is desiring a relationship that is pure. So I'm needing you to understand and to see that there's a common theme that's taking place in both of these passages. We're going to read a little bit more in the book of Solomon. But what I want you to know is basically what I'm trying to get a point across to you is that in both stories we have a bridegroom. And the bridegroom is representative of Jesus. In both stories we have a bride. And the bride is representative of the people of God, and more specifically to you and I as New Testament Christians, as you and I, those of us who have given our heart to Jesus. If you haven't given your heart to Jesus, it's real important that you do, amen? And we'll talk about that, I'm sure, before this message is over. And so, but at the same time, we see that within the bride itself, there's wise ones and there's unwise ones. At least we saw that in the parable. And I got to tell you that in the story of Solomon, as we go through, you're going to see that too. The same bride, she vacillates. She goes back and forth. She goes back and forth between being prepared and ready to not being prepared and becoming sleepy. And in her sleep or her slumber, she realizes that she's missed the opportunity, just as the five unwise virgins missed the opportunity. As a matter of fact, let's go ahead and turn, if you will, with me to the Song of Solomon, or Sandy can put it up on. It's right after the book of Ecclesiastes, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. just a couple of things that I want to mention to you about the Song of Solomon. Now I will tell you this. The Song of Solomon, if you read the literal interpretation, it's been noted by many scholars that it's descriptive of erotic love. Okay, and if you read it on the surface, that there's a lot of eroticism, a lot of romantic love that's based upon this. Now, in our carnal minds, if we begin to equate God and His love to the bride as this form of eroticism, we get all messed up. We get all twisted off. But what I will tell you is this, is that in the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 6, I'm pretty sure it is. It says, knowing that our old man has been crucified with Jesus. Now, what I need you to understand is that that's a major concept of the gospel. As you're turning to the Song of Solomon, I'm just trying to explain something. That's a major concept of the gospel. That the old man born of Adam, upon faith, spiritually, has been crucified with Jesus at the cross.
Amen.
Has been buried with Jesus in the tomb. And a new man has been resurrected to newness of life. I'm not talking about physical death. I'm talking about a death to your old man that was born like Adam. Now the truth of the matter is that some people's old man was really, really bad. Amen. My old man was really, really bad. But you can't come up in here thinking, yeah, but I wasn't like you, preacher. I wasn't as bad as you were. No, we're all born of Adam, and we're all born in sin. And Jeremiah said this, that the heart of man is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? There are things and thoughts in our hearts and in our minds that people don't know that are completely contrary to the ways of God. Yes. What I want you to know about this word knowing is this. In the Greek, it's gnosko. I don't know that it's important. I'm not asking you to memorize this, but you spell it like this. G-I-N-O-S-K-O. One of the meanings of gnosko is that it's like a Jewish thought, or the Jewish people would have used it in their translation in the Greek, the Septuagint, I don't mean to get all technical on you, as sexual intimacy. Now, once again, we can't allow our carnal minds to get twisted off thinking that, but there's no closer or better way to describe in human language oneness between two and a deep understanding or an intimate knowledge of two different people in a relationship than when you come into that sexual union, right? Now, if you're thinking bad thoughts right now, I'm telling you right now that you're off track and you're on the wrong road because God's not like that. But the idea is that human marriage in the confines of the way God created it was supposed to be pure. Amen? Amen. Praise God. So this, Lord, help our minds to be pure. But what the idea behind it is that there's an intimate knowledge, an intimate understanding, a knowing between the bride and the bridegroom in a way that's not just superficial.
Amen.
It's not just, you understand what I'm trying to get at. There's a deep understanding and a knowledge. All right. So in the book of Song of Solomon, it says right here that in chapter 1, verse 13, this is the bride speaking, the Shulamite woman, and she's speaking about the bridegroom. And this is what it says: a bundle of myrrh is my well-beloved unto me. He shall lie all night between my breasts. All right. So one of the things that I want you to understand is this. Now, the line between her breasts, I mean, if we look at it physically, we're going to get twisted off. But what it's describing is intimacy.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Closeness. Does that make sense? Yes. Praise God. All right. Now, at the same time, I don't even want to focus on that right now. What I want to focus on is the first part of the passage, a bundle of myrrh. Amen. I want you to understand that a bundle of myrrh, it has meaning to the ancient people. Well, what did it mean? Well, Jesus, in his gifts, when he was the Messiah born in a manger, received three gifts from the wise men. It was gold, frankincense, and myrrh. He received gold because he was a king. He was the king of the Jews. He received frankincense because frankincense was something that was utilized by the high priest on a regular basis, and he was going to be a high priest as he offered himself as a sacrifice for our sin, and myrrh was used to embalm dead bodies. All of these gifts, especially the myrrh, was a foreshadowing of the day when two men, one named Nicodemus and one named Joseph of Arimathea, would go take the body of Jesus off a cross and take myrrh with them and spikenard and other types of instances and embalm his body. To the Jewish reader, maybe not to your mind, maybe not to your heart, but to the Jewish reader of this time, when the word myrrh was mentioned, it was always connected in some way, shape, or form with death. Myrrh was a gum resin that was received or harvested from trees, and it had a very strong fragrance, and it was an inviting fragrance. She sang of her beloved that his love is inviting, that it's attractive. It's not a love that's repelling her, but not only that, it's a love of sacrifice. His love for her is a love that's willing to die for her, and that's how she sees it. His love is connected to myrrh, which is a love that's willing to die. Now listen, in chapter 2, verse 2, here's the bridegroom talking. This morning I was just going back through this and I said, you know, I got to mention a couple of these things. Chapter 2, verse 2, this is the bridegroom talking. He says, as the lily among thorns, so is my love among the daughters. What does that mean? See, the daughters here, once again, in one parable we have 10 virgins. In this parable we have the Shulamite woman, but we have other daughters. He's saying, the bridegroom is saying, that my love is like a lily among thorns. I've never been caught in a thorn thicket. I don't want to. I think there was a story about Brer Rabbit. He was caught in a thorn thicket, right? He was caught in a thorn thicket. It's a mess. There's nothing pretty about a thorn thicket. But what Jesus is saying right here in this passage of Scripture, if you'll allow us to fast forward, if we can believe that God knew what he was writing from the beginning to the end, is that my love is like a lily that you would find in the midst of a thorn thicket. No, now, what is that talking about? Well, because see, when you navigate your life on this fallen earth that has been tainted with the sin of Adam, sometimes it's like your Brer Rabbit caught up in a thorn thicket. There's nothing pretty around you. If you turn the page and you look, he also says it's like an apple tree amongst the woods. What does that mean? A wooded area that has nothing in it except one apple tree. It's a beautiful apple tree. It's got fruit on it. It's something that can be eaten. Hallelujah. Taken a hold of in the midst of a big old forest that has nothing else to offer. It kind of goes back to the parable that we talked about last week in the book of Matthew. The kingdom of heaven is like a man that found a treasure hidden in a field. When he found that treasure hidden in the field, you know what he did? He went and sold everything else that he had. Why? So that he could turn around and buy that field. Because that field, he found hidden a treasure in the midst of it. What you talking about? All my life I've been walking around on this crazy fallen earth looking for something that was going to bring me fulfillment. And people are looking for it in a bottle. People look for it in a baggie. People look for it in a relationship. People look for it in a job. People look for it in more education. People look for it in their offspring. People try to find fulfillment in so many different areas, and the reality of it is, he's saying, I'm a lily in a thorn thicket. I'm an apple tree in the midst of the woods. I'm a hidden treasure in the midst of a field. But the question is, when you get a hold of the hidden treasure, are you going to be willing to sell everything else that you knew to come back to this? This is what the bridegroom wants you to know. This is what my love looks like. Hallelujah. And so what she says, though, in the midst of all of this, she says, my beloved spoke and said unto me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away, for the winter is past. The rain is over and gone. What the bridegroom is offering to her is an invitation. Just as in the parable of the 10 virgins, and we're going to talk a little bit about the Jewish wedding here in a moment, the offer of the wedding has already been made. In this passage, he's now offering her in matrimony. He's saying, I want to be your bridegroom. I want you to be my bride. He's saying, won't you come away with me? The winter is past. What do you think of when you think of winter?
Cold.
But what does it do to the branches? What does it do to the woods? Everything becomes brown, dead, dry. See, and what happens after the rain to the Jewish mind? The rain was connected to harvest. There was the former rain, the latter rain. The rain's already come. It's time now for the harvest. It's time, amen, for the good times, the rejoicing times to come. Your life before Jesus was like a winter. Come on, somebody, help me out here. Your life, and you know what? If you haven't received Jesus yet, your life might be like a winter right now. And sometimes even when you know Jesus, you feel like I'm still in the midst of a winter place. Yeah. But I'm here to tell you that the old dried up brown branches of winter can give way to green new foliage. Because it's called new life. Hallelujah. Jesus has come to bring resurrection life. Amen. And so this is the invitation. Now, real quick, I want you to see, and then we're going to go back to the parable. Chapter 3, verse 1. This, the Song of Solomon, if you don't understand this part too, it can get confusing. It's made up of at least three different dreams. All right? And so she, the bride, is dreaming on at least three different occasions. And it says in chapter 3, verse 1, and this is one of her dreams. By night on my bed I sought him whom my soul loveth. I sought him, but I found him not. I will rise now and go about the city and the streets, and in the broad ways I will seek him whom my soul loveth. I sought him, but I found him not. So what we see here is a picture of the bride laying in her bed. She's actually dreaming. She's already been invited to be married to the bridegroom. And in this dream, she's anticipating. She's ready, amen, to have a relationship. She wants to be in his presence. She wants to be with him. And she gets up and she begins to search for him. And see, I can't find him. She begins to search for him. And then it says right here that she comes in contact with the watchman. Verse 3. The watchman that go about the city found me, to whom I said, saw ye him whom my soul loveth? It was but a little that I passed from them, but I found him whom my soul loveth. I held him and would not let him go until I had brought him into my mother's house and into the chamber of her that conceived me. Once again, we get a picture of intimacy, but when she found him, she grabbed a hold of him. She didn't want to let him go. It was like the treasure once again in the field. It was the most important thing. Everything else was sold, and that field was bought because now this is where that person's going to live. Every decision from that day moving forward, when you gave your life to Jesus, who you were going to marry, where you were going to work, who you were going to hang out with, the places you were going to go. If you really got a hold of the real Jesus, it started to affect you. I'm not trying to say you never made a mistake since you gave your heart to the Lord. Come on, somebody, help me out here. What I'm trying to say is that when you get a hold of the real Jesus and the kingdom gets birthed in your heart, the Holy Spirit starts to move you in a direction. When you grab a hold of him, you don't want to let go of him.
Amen.
Now, I want to share something with you real quick about the watchman. The watchman in Israel, as a matter of fact, we have a passage of scripture. I'm not going to turn there for sake of time. You know what? Let's go ahead and do it.
Amen.
Ezekiel chapter 37. I'm sorry, not 37. Ezekiel chapter 3.
3?
Yeah, Ezekiel chapter 3. Let me see. Verse 17. I want to give you a picture of the watchman. This is what God told Ezekiel. Ezekiel was a prophet during a time in Israel's history. And by the way, if you feel like you leave here today, listen to me, the Holy Spirit is going to speak something to your heart today that you'll be able to use today in your life. I'm telling you, he will. At the same time, you might leave here feeling like, man, I don't really know some of this stuff. Rand in his silliness was telling Danielle the other day, I didn't even know that, man. I didn't know that. I think I'm going to hell. He was being silly because he was trying to clown me for how much information I was giving out. But that's not the point. It's not about just giving information. The only reason I give the information is I'm trying to help people understand the Bible better so that they'll understand the context. Amen. Amen. But what I am trying to say is this. The prophet Ezekiel was during a time frame in Israel's history when they were disobedient to God, okay? And the prophet is a mouthpiece. God speaks his word through the mouthpiece. God gave his word to us in written form so that we might know his will. God wanted Israel at this time of their disobedience to know his will. So what he said was, he called Ezekiel son of man, which is a title in the New Testament used of Jesus. But he's saying, son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, hear the word at my mouth and give them warning from me. Next verse. You can just keep going. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way, to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at your hand. Next verse. Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered your soul. Next verse. Again, when a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die. Because thou hast not given him warning, he shall die in his sin, and his righteousness which he hath done shall not be remembered, but his blood will I require at thy hand. Next verse. Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he doth not sin, he shall surely live. Because he is warned, also thou hast delivered thy soul. Now, let's try to get a picture of this. The watchmen, many times, many cities back in the ancient times would have a fenced area, a gated area, or a wall around them to protect them, and they'd have a watchtower. And the watchman sat in the watchtower. And what he did was he was looking for danger. He was here to announce danger and to sound the alarm if danger was coming. Now, God uses the watchman to the Ezekiel the prophet as an illustration, saying, you're the watchman, Ezekiel, and you have to speak forth the truth. So in a certain sense, Ezekiel is representative of the word of God, if it would let me to explain it to you that way. Hopefully, it's not that difficult to wrap your mind around it, because you see, the written word of God is like a warning from God. It's like it's letting us know. It's sounding an alarm. It shows us the character of God. It shows us the plan of God. It shows us the way not to go, and it shows us the way to go. And just as God wanted the watchman and Ezekiel to sound the alarm to let the people know when they were headed in the wrong direction, with the Shulamite woman, she's in the midst of her dream. She's longing to find the presence of God, or the presence of her bridegroom, and she frantically searches in the streets. And the word of God tells us in the Song of Solomon that not long after she begins her search, she comes upon the watchman of the city, and then right after she comes upon the watchman, she finds her bridegroom. And when she finds her bridegroom, she grabs a hold of him, and she doesn't want to let him go. The point that I wanted to make you know is this, and let's go back to the concept of the Jewish wedding. There were three parts to a Jewish wedding, and to tell you the truth, I've memorized the parts before, and like I said, I've never partaken in a Jewish wedding, so please forgive me if you've studied it and you know it better than I do, or if that happens to be your culture and you know it better than I do. But there was a first part of the Jewish wedding that was known as the contractual part. Now, one person, I've taught on this before, and some lady actually watched on YouTube, and oh, this was a great teaching. The only problem I have is that he called it a contract and not a covenant. Well, okay, but a covenant is in some forms a contract. And yes, it is a covenant, but at the same time, we need to understand that it is contractual. Okay, now what I need you to understand is that what does that mean? Well, when it said that Mary was espoused to Joseph, that means that they had already entered into this part of the Jewish wedding. They had already come under the contractual version of the Jewish wedding. Their espousal or betrothal was not the same thing as our engagement. That's why it said that he was going to give her a letter to put her away, a letter of divorcement to put her away. Even though they have not come together yet and consummated and known each other intimately, they are legally married in the eyes of God according to the Jewish wedding. Now, what would it be like for you and I? Well, it would be kind of like a situation where you said, we want to get married now. We're going to get married at the Justice of the Peace, but in 2 weeks we're coming over to the church and we're going to get to a religious ceremony. So this is the civil portion of the Jewish wedding. The religious portion is going to take place whenever the bridegroom comes back. Now, what happens is that there's a period of time where the bridegroom leaves. Now, during that period of time in between his return, The tradition goes that he would go back to his father's house and he would prepare a place for his bride. He would build oftentimes an annex or a portion onto his father's house. Now, you know what's a beautiful thing is that when Jesus is talking to his disciples in John chapter 14, he tells them that he's going away. And what they begin to say in the midst of that is they seem to be sorrowful. They seem to be sad. And what Jesus says is that it's a good thing that I go away. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go away to prepare a place for you. He's preparing a place for a bride. And he says, if it were not so, I would not tell you. I'm coming back again. Amen. And so every bride realized that when the contractual portion of the marriage had taken place, and it required a purchase price, by the way. There was a dowry that had to be paid. There was a price that had to be paid. The first time when Jesus came, hallelujah, to purchase a bride, he purchased her through the shedding of his blood. That's why the bride in Song of Solomon's beloved love, my well-beloved, he's like a bundle of myrrh, because the love that Jesus showed for his bride was a love that was sacrificial in nature. It was the giving of himself. He said the Son of Man came not to be served or ministered to, but to minister unto others and to lay down his life as a ransom for many. The first time Jesus showed up, he came for one purpose, hallelujah, that to reveal the Father and to die on the cross to give us access, and so that our sin debt could be paid, so that we could have a relationship, hallelujah, with the Father and enter into his presence. And even while you're still on this earth, even though it's fallen, even though it's all messed up, you can have access to the presence of God. Not the preacher. The preacher can't help you unless he leads you to Jesus. Amen. The preacher's presence ain't going to bring you anywhere unless the words that he speaks are the words of truth, and he leads and guides you to Jesus. And if you go through Jesus, you'll be able to get into the presence of a living God, hallelujah, that offers grace in the midst of circumstances, and he strengthens you, and he heals you, and he brings deliverance unto you. Yeah. So in this period of time, he's gone off between the contractual portion. But then when he comes back, the ceremonial aspect takes place. In the ceremonial aspect, from what I understand, they would stand under a canopy. And actually, in the Song of Solomon, there's a passage where she says that under the banner of his love. The banner, the canopy, is called a huppah. And it represented that God was in their relationship, God was in their marriage, and that it had to do with the fact that he was their covering. But they would stand under the huppah, and they would give their vows, they would go through the ceremonial aspect of the marriage. But it wasn't until the consummation took place, where they came together and they were intimate with one another, that it was considered completely final. Does that make sense? All right. And so the truth of the matter is that we as a bride have already been purchased by Jesus. Amen. He offered his life as a sacrifice for our sin. He's gone away to the Father. He's preparing a place for us. And he's going to come back again for his bride. Amen. Amen. And when that takes place, according to the book of Revelation, there's a wedding feast, if you will, and the marriage supper of the Lamb that we will partake in. And in the Jewish wedding, they would also have a marriage feast that typically lasted about 7 days. Amen. And during that time frame, the marriage was consummated, and to where they actually, in the Hebrew scriptures, the idea is that they became a oneness. And there's going to be a day when the bride of Christ is going to become one with him. And once again, let's not get carnal on it, but the oneness of the marriage, the married couple, you can't get any closer than that whenever they come back together. And unfortunately, the enemy of our souls perverted everything. We're all jacked up in our thinking. But from God's idea, there's a oneness that takes place in that. And it's representative of the fact that God wants to be at one with his people, and he wants to have them in his presence. And one day, the scripture says, God will rule and reign, hallelujah, upon this earth, and his people are going to be there with him. Yeah. God's going to be their God, and they're going to be his people. Amen. Amen. And so now if we go back to Matthew chapter 25, what we begin to see is, we begin to see that this is exactly what we're dealing with here. The marriage. The bridegroom has already come, and he's invited the bride to come away with him. He's already gone through the contractual portion. Jesus is talking about this as he's about to go to the cross. He's literally about to go to the cross. He's giving parables about the kingdom. And I mean, in just the next couple of days, he's going to be dying on the cross. And while he's about to die on the cross, he's already talking about his return. He's desiring for his disciples and the people that are going to follow him to be looking for his return. And so what we see here is we have 10 virgins. The wedding, they're waiting for the bridegroom to come back. And what they have, though, is this is interesting to me. They all have lamps. Now, I can tell you that to the Jewish reader, the idea of a lamp definitely would have brought their mind to the Word of God. Just as the watchman, I tried to make the point to you in Ezekiel, amen. The watchman, in some way, you got to give it to me, at least representative of God desiring to warn the people, make the people aware, amen, that he's coming back, that there's a proper way. But in the similar fashion, I give you scripture for the lamp connected to the Word of God. Can you put Psalm 119, 105 up there? Their greatest king that ever lived, King David, wrote a psalm, and in Psalm 119, verse 105, he equates the Word of God to the lamp of God. Amen? And so I just want you to go ahead and see that. If you got your script, if you got your Bible, you can turn. Did we lose contact? Psalm 119.
119,
105. Alright. There we go. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now you know what a lamp does? A lamp is gonna shine a light. The idea is that we need a lamp to be able to see the next step we're going to take. But not only that, the light, it enlightens the path. So you got a longer distance visual, you got a shorter distance visual, but the thing that's enlightening you and preparing you and giving you the right direction is the Word of God. All 10 of these virgins have a lamp in their hand. I'm venturing to tell you that all 10 of these virgins represent the church that we're talking about today. And all 10 of these virgins represent the church that's in the time frame between the fact that Jesus died on the cross and the fact that there's a day when he's coming back. Amen. 5 of them have oil in their lamp, 5 of them don't. Invariably, the oil is always representative of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit giving illumination to the Word of God, we're lost. I'm here to tell you. You can have a Bible in your house and you can read it all day long. You can say, I don't need to go to church. I don't need to fellowship with none of those people. Or I can just pick me some preachers that I like what they tell me. And the reality of it is that if they are not being moved upon, and if they are not telling you the scripture based upon what the Holy Spirit would say about the scripture, and instead they're being moved upon by another spirit of another hold on a second, church. Don't get mad at me. I'm here to tell you that everybody that you watch on television and every church that you go to, just because a man stands behind the sacred desk and tells you that he's a preacher of the gospel, listen to me. Don't get offended at what I'm telling you. I'm here to tell you the Bible warns against the fact that there are going to be people that will stand up and they will purposefully tell you one thing, and the reality of it is that it is something else. Amen. I'm here to tell you that you need the Spirit of God. Amen. To illuminate the Word of God. Amen. In order for you to be able to see where it is that you hallelujah. He's coming back one day. He's coming back for a bride. Hallelujah. And if you don't have any oil in your lamp, if you're not willing to listen to what the watchman tells you, then you're not going to be able to find him. In the interim between his first coming and his second coming, the only way that you will ever know this Jesus that I preached to you this morning is if you get in this book and you learn, hallelujah, about Jesus for yourself. And the only way you'll ever want to know the Jesus that I preached to you this morning is if you let him move into your heart and to die. And listen, he already died for your sin. I told somebody the other day when I was witnessing to him out there at the Shrimp and Petroleum Festival, I might have told y'all this before. I said, this is the thing, buddy. He's already died for you. He already died for you. He died for you. He died for me. You got a deposit. It's already in the bank. It's waiting for you. But you, because he already told me, he said, you can talk to me all day long, but you're not going to convince me. I said, but the problem with you is, sir, is this. You refuse to go pick it up. You refuse to go take out your withdrawal. Jesus has already died for you.
Amen.
He's done everything that he's ever going to do for you. And you refuse to go take out your withdrawal.
Right.
You, I didn't tell him this, but he was an unwise virgin. He wasn't even really one of them because he was refusing to even believe the truth to begin with. And I have to tell you that this is what we're seeing in this situation. That listen to me, it says right here, they took the foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. Verse 4. We're back at Matthew 25. Verse 4. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. It says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. What is that saying? It's saying that he didn't come as quickly as what they would hope that he would come.
Right.
If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 3. This is another one I run into. Well, I love talking to people about Jesus out on the outside. I don't know about you, but maybe that's just my little thing. I love talking to people about Jesus on the outside. And because I do that, I run into all kind of stuff.
2 Peter
chapter 3. I'm just trying to go through the scriptures with you this morning to show you some things. See, in the Matthew passage, he tarried. In other words, he didn't come back as quickly as what they thought. They got sleepy. They started to fall asleep. This can happen to the best of us.
Yes.
We sitting here waiting, and it's like, well, when's Jesus going to come back? He said he was going to come back. And then we're going through the actual day-to-day grind of life. This starts to wear us down. Amen?
Amen.
And we're like, man, I wish he'd show up. When's he going to show up? Well, this is what people are going to, if you listen to enough people out there, this is what they're going to tell you. I've had people tell me before, dude, you believe that's fairy tale? Hey, when's he coming back, man? He's been saying he was going to come back. He hadn't come back.
Wow.
This is what they say right here. 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack. That's another word, way to say lazy or slow. Concerning his promise, as some men count slowness or slackness. But he's long-suffering. What does that mean? It means he has patience in relationships. Has anybody ever done you wrong?
Yes.
And what did you want to do in your flesh?
Revenge.
You want revenge, right? That's not how God is. God's not like that.
Amen.
He has nothing to do with that. That is the enemy of your soul. That wants to plant bitterness on the inside of your heart. God is long-suffering. What does that mean? He has patience in relationships. That means you've done him wrong, but he has waited. He's waited one more day for you to get your heart right.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
I don't know if you needed that help, but I needed that help. I still need it today.
Yes.
Lord, please be long-suffering.
Yes.
And teach me your long-suffering. Amen? Yes. So this is why he waits. Not because he's slow, not because he's lazy, not because he tarries just to make you mad, but he's long-suffering to us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be. And when he does come, it's going to happen at a time when nobody is expecting.
Yes.
The book of 2 Thessalonians says that you and I should not be taken as a thief in the night because we have the word of God preparing us. Amen? Now this is what I wanted you to see really. 2 Peter 3, go back to verse 3. This is what the people today are saying. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, meaning died, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. So essentially, just as the bridegroom tarried, people in society, as Jesus has gone away to the Father's house to prepare a place for his bride, and he's taken this long interim in between, people are walking around after their own lust, saying, man, I'm going to live any old way I want to live. I'm going to do whatever it is I want to do. I'm not going to listen to the watchman. I'm not going to put any oil in my lamp. I don't even care about a lamp because I don't believe it, because I'm a scoffer and I think that it's a lie and it's a fairy tale and it's never, ever going to happen. And what the Lord is saying to us is this: no, I'm waiting. I'm being long-suffering because, see, God's got a big plan. And there's a plan, I hate to say it, but it's true, that's bigger than our individual self. us. He's very concerned about our individual self. You understand that?
Mm-hmm.
He died on the cross just for you, just for me. But he's got a big plan, and he wants other people, amen, to come and to be part of the eternal family.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so in this story, they have no oil with them, and they slumbered and they slept. You know, there's multiple passages of scripture. Maybe Sandy, you could get ready. I got a few different scriptures that I wanted to put up there. First, that talk about for us not to fall asleep. The scriptures repeatedly tell us, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 6 through 8, telling us not to fall asleep. It says right here, therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober.
Amen.
Now listen to me. It's one thing to be physically drunk. But this is not what it's talking about right there. It's talking about being spiritually sober. So let me ask you something. You don't have to raise your hand. But have you ever been drunk before?
No.
Lord knows I've been. Too many times. One of the things that I remember about being drunk is this. When I got drunk, I couldn't talk right. I couldn't see right. I didn't hear right. I didn't really know where I was going.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In a spiritual sense, when you're blinded to the truth, you ain't thinking right. You can't hear right.
Yes.
You can't talk right.
No,
you don't know where you don't act right. That's why the Lord, first thing when I got saved, the Lord told me, I'm just telling you what he told me, son, for you, you ain't supposed to be drinking. Why? You know what I realized later, why the Lord didn't want me drinking? And I could break down a whole lot of different scripture for you, but let me just tell you what the Lord showed me. When you drink, you don't act nothing like a Christian,
amen,
son.
Amen.
You act just like the old man.
Yes.
You put a little bit of alcohol in your bloodstream, and the next thing you know, everything starts changing.
Yes.
You start living your old life the way, any old way that you want to live your life, and you are no longer worried about my word. Listen to me. Don't fall asleep. Instead, we need to watch. Be watchful, virgins. Be watchful, bride, in the Song of Solomon. Don't get sleepy. Don't fall asleep on the bed and not be longing and waiting for the return of your bridegroom. It says right here, look at verse 7. The next verse. For they that sleep in the night, they that be drunken are drunken in the night. And what does it say? It says that he's coming back in the night. And people that they're sleeping are sleeping at night. They're being drunk at night. But the word of the Lord is telling us we need to be awake.
Amen.
Next verse. But let us who are of the day be sober. In other words, the idea is you're of the day, you're of the light. The daytime is light, the nighttime is darkness. People that don't have a relationship with God are walking in darkness. People that have a relationship with God are supposed to be walking in the light. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Nothing was created that wasn't created through Him. He was the life of man. He was life, and His life was the light of men. Jesus is the light of God, and He came to bring that light and to put that light on the inside of us. I quoted it to you a while back in Ephesians 1:18. It says that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened. Well, I remember the first time I read that passage. Well, I didn't know that my understanding had eyes. I didn't know that my heart, my inner man, had eyes. Spiritually, God wants me to be able to see what's going on.
Yeah.
He doesn't want me walking around at nighttime in darkness, sleepy and drunk spiritually to where I can't see that there's something happening upon this earth upon which we live.
Amen.
There's a reason that the Muslim ran over 50, 60 people in France. There's a reason that people are doing the terror acts that they're doing, because we're nearing the end of the age, and the enemy of our soul is moving and operating through lying religions to cause hate, to cause destruction. Come on, somebody, you gotta help me out here. The Bible warned against it. And it's not my fault that the government isn't smart enough to figure out something that a silly little Cajun boy in South Louisiana can figure out. I can see it. I don't need a physics degree to figure out that Islam is not a religion of love. Now, are there some people that are good? Yes, there are. There are some people that don't necessarily want to blow me up. At least I don't think so. I mean, I got a couple of patients. They went over there to Petra. They brought me back little gifts. They she made me some baklava. I ate it, man. I said, hey, Lord bless it. If she tried to take me out, you know, so be it. You know, I ate the baklava, man. It was good. Okay? At the same time, I didn't shrink back. I told her about Jesus. I told her husband about it. I said, sir, you grew up in Jerusalem and your daddy used to pick olives in the garden on the Mount of Olives? Okay, well, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you this. The scripture says in the Old Testament, you read the Old Testament, right? Yes. In the book of Genesis, it says that Isaac, his name shall be called. Not Ishmael. That Isaac was the promised seed. Look at here it is right here, sir. Genesis chapter 17. Did you know that? Look, it's on my phone right here. Oh, well, I don't read the Old Testament like I should. I said, sir, that's a problem. Because, see, Isaac is a type of Jesus.
Yes.
And Jesus is the one that died on the cross for sin. The martyr can't shed his blood. His blood is tainted with sin. I'm getting off track here. We're not supposed to fall asleep. We're not supposed to get sleepy. We're not supposed to be drunk. We're supposed to be awake. We're supposed to be watchful. We're supposed to be sober. And not just caught up in our own circumstances. Sometimes things hit us that we can't help but get caught up in it, and the Lord will deliver us out. Amen. Right. But we got to understand that there's also a bigger picture out there. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 13, verse 11. If you could put that up there real quick. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. Every day it gets closer to the end. Every day the long suffering is shortened a little bit. Jesus is going to come back, no matter what the scoffers say. And when that happens, it's going to be a situation like the five unwise virgins. When they tried to get in, the door was shut and it was too late. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 real quick. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. That means that one day, the revelation of Jesus Christ, the word revelation, if you didn't know this, literally means an unveiling. In other words, if I had like a big sheet over this pulpit right here, and I pulled it up, and I revealed the pulpit to you, the idea is that the whole book of Revelation is talking about the unveiling of Jesus. There's going to be a day upon this earth where the scoffer's mouth is going to be shut, because all the world is going to see with physical eyes the reality of Jesus when he returns. Hallelujah. All the guesswork is going to be taken out. And look what it says, though. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. You know what gird up means is that back in the old days, they'd wear these long kind of flowing robe type things, and they'd have like a belt. I've explained this to the church, you know, in the past. What they'd do is when they were ready to go on a journey, they would take the backside of that robe and they'd pull it up through the front. They'd stick it through their belt like that and they'd cinch it up like that because they didn't want that stuff getting in the way of them. Now they can travel. Now they're ready. So they'd gird up their loins. Peter's saying you need to gird up the loins of your mind. You're on a journey, Christian. Yeah. You're on a journey and you're traveling through this thing called Christianity. You're traveling through this thing called life. You need to be sober. You need to be hopeful and understand that, hallelujah, Jesus is coming back again. Yeah. Don't get blinded by the ways of the world.
Yes.
We're going to talk about that in a second.
Yes.
I want you to see 1 Peter 5, 8 real quick. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. If there's any one entity upon this earth that wants you drunk, that wants you sleepy, that wants you blind, it's the enemy of your soul.
Right?
I want you to turn, go to Ephesians 5:18 real quick. Says, and be not drunk with wine, whereas in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, what I wanted you to see with this is this. The Spirit, we've already said, is illumination. The illumination of the Word of God. We talked earlier about whenever you're physically drunk, when you put wine in your body, what happens? It begins to diffuse into your bloodstream, right? It begins to move upon your cognitive functions in your brain. And it begins to change things.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It changes the way that you feel. Yeah. It changes the way that you think. It changes the way that you... Y'all follow me, what I'm trying to say. In a similar fashion, spiritually, when the believer allows the Holy Spirit to be part of his life, hearing the voice of God, the voice of God, the Holy Spirit, His grace begins to flow through our inner man, beginning to open up the eyes that we might see. You can close them back again and go back to sleep if that's what you choose to do. But one day you might wake up and the door's going to be shut. I'm preaching to the preacher. Don't fall back asleep, Christian. The Holy Spirit moving and operating in your life, opening up your eyes, opening up your ears. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody the other day was telling me, man, I used to understand the gospel so much, I went the wrong way, and it was almost like God blinded my eyes, He deafened my ears, and now all of a sudden it's coming alive again.
Amen.
I heard myself talking to people about things that I knew back then. Oh, hallelujah. The Holy Spirit will open your eyes, open your ears. He will begin to lead you and guide you in all truth.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, I want you to see this real quick, too, Revelation 17, 2, because we're talking about blindness. They had lamps. They didn't have illumination. It says right here, this is talking about, this is pretty deep. As a matter of fact, I want you to go back to verse 1. I'm probably trying to bite off more than I can chew.
Yeah.
Yeah, somebody say yeah. Yeah, okay. That's all right. I do this all the time.
We love it.
You
got to
bear with me. Y'all know I love it, man.
It
says, and there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials and talked with me, saying unto me, come here, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sits upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Next verse. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names, blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. Go back to verse 2. So what we see is we see a harlot riding on a seven-headed beast. Now this is definitely illustrative, definitely mystical. This is the book of Revelation. Now I'm going to tell you, after years of study, I'm just going to break it down real quick. The harlot represents false religion. All false religion. Starting from the Tower of Babel, moving through. You want me to list them? I'm going to list them. No, don't call me a hater. I'm a lover. I'm a lover of the human soul by the grace that God has given me. That's why I'm willing to tell the Buddhist that would watch the video, the Muslim that would watch the video, the Christian that would watch the video, the truth about God's plan and God's word. Because if I'm telling the truth and they don't believe in the Jesus that died on the cross for their sin, then they will split hell wide open. And don't tell me, I've talked to people on the street out there before and they're like, how could you love a God that sends people to hell? No, no, ma'am. No, sir. God's not sending anybody to hell. God sent a lamb. He sent a lamb. His name was Jesus.
Amen.
The only begotten of the Father, born of a virgin. Never once did he sin. Never once did he fail. And what he did was he came searching for a bride, and he purchased that bride through the shedding of his precious blood. He laid down his life so that others might live. But the harlot represents all false religion. If there was an enemy of your soul, I was sharing this with a nursing student the other day. I'm a nurse practitioner too. She came over there, you know, she got to follow me around, and I tried to keep it cool, but you know, look, hey, door opened up. If you were the devil, how would you trick people? Well, if I was the devil, I would make many ways. I'd come up with many plans. Give people like almost like a little choice. You can choose the way you want to go. And we'll have a whole bunch of scriptures, a whole bunch of words that you can read. And don't judge them. Because they don't believe the way you do. I'm not going to judge anybody. The Word of God judges us.
Amen.
Watchmen, I need you to speak forth unto my people that they might know that you would warn them from their sin. I need them to be able to be illuminated through the Holy Spirit in my Word that they might know that I have a way. If I was the devil, I'd make a whole bunch of different ways. Some of you right now, you might be cringing in your seat. I'm not saying you are, but there's the possibility that you are. That I would speak this way. Somebody on that video is going to cringe and see. I'm telling you right now. Because there's a spirit of Antichrist.
Right.
It's the harlot. The spirit of Antichrist is coming against words like what I'm saying right now.
Amen.
They call me intolerant. They say that I'm intolerant of people's lifestyles. They say that I'm intolerant of other religions. I'm here to tell you, no, I am tolerant of the Word of God. I love every homosexual that walks upon the face of the earth. I love every fornicator. I love every drug user. I love every alcoholic. Paul said, don't forget, because you used to be just like them.
Amen.
But the truth is the truth. And the light dispels darkness.
Yes.
And God has a way. And man has a false way that he's following after a liar. And the harlot offers other religions. And she rides the back of a beast, which represent corrupt governments. And corrupt governments, along with false religion, have blinded eyes, have darkened, brought darkness instead of light, have caused drunkenness, verse 2, with whom the kings of the earth, not just King Louis, no, leaders today,
yes,
through the ages. Psalm chapter 2 says it. Why do the heathen rage? Why do the leaders imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth, the rulers, they set themselves. They take counsel together. They say, let us break their bands asunder. Let us cast their cords away from us against the Lord and his anointed.
Yes.
The scripture says that from the beginning, kings of the earth have been driven by demonic powers to come against God to try to usurp his authority.
Yes.
And listen to me, they're trying to bring it even now. When you see things that are happening, when Britain exits the European Union, it's because they're saying that there's a bunch of elitists out there that are trying to hone us in and take away our sovereignty. They're trying to do it in America. And if you can't see it through the eyes of what the people are saying, some of the people that are campaigning, that I can't have, darkness has already set in. But what they want to do is they want to go to other countries and they want to bow down to them. They want to go and they want to say, you, we're stronger together in one and we're all except. No, this country was built on sovereignty. This country sent people to other countries to preach the truth of Jesus Christ, and we do not need to allow ourselves to be part of a mixed mash of a whole and telling other people, the European Union or the United Nations, what we should be doing or what we shouldn't be doing. We need the people of the church to seek the face of God, hallelujah, and cry out to the Lord to have mercy on this country.
Amen.
Lord, we repent of killing innocent babies. Lord, we repent of the sin that's been going on in our lives. Lord, help us. Our hearts are hard. We've been blinded. We're in the midst of darkness. We've been made drunk. We're no longer sober. We can't see. You can't do that. God gives life. You can't take it.
Amen.
I wish I could talk more, but I can't talk freely. I like to talk about things that I've experienced, in my own life. Things that have touched me. But it's not fair for me sometimes to tell the whole story. But I can tell you right now, it's not of the Lord. Whenever we take innocent life, it's not of the Lord.
Right.
The harlot has caused the inhabitants of the earth, the leaders of countries, to become drunk. She's also caused the inhabitants of the world to become drunk. And the harlot is not just Islam, Buddhism, blah, whatever. The harlot is also crept in, not just into Catholicism. Come on, somebody. I'm gonna say
amen.
That, but also
amen.
Into the Protestant church.
Amen.
False doctrine, a lying devil tongue to cause confusion. All people hate it when I talk like this. I've had people call me up, dude, you beat up everybody, man. You're the only one that think you're right. Come on, man. I know I'm not the only one that's right. Give me a break. The Word of God's right. The preacher's not right. The Word of God's right. And if I get the Word of God right, if I get the Word of God wrong, then I'm wrong, brother.
Amen.
Who in the world would be causing this blindness? Who is behind this harlot? Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, please. It's blindness. It's a slumber. Don't get away from our main text. He's coming back.
Amen.
He's coming back, but he tarried and they got sleepy. Paul says to the church of Corinth, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. Next verse. In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Good next verse. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. Next verse. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The only way you'll ever see God is if you see Jesus. The only way you'll ever see Jesus is if you get into the Word. But not just get into the Word, have illumination of the Word. It says right here, if our gospel be hid, it's hidden because of the God of this world. He's blinded the eyes of the lost. But it's talking about the lost, preacher. It's not talking about the believer. Believers can't be lost. Oh, please. If you got a lamp without oil, you're lost.
Amen.
If you're being led down the wrong road by another spirit, then you're lost.
Amen.
Why do you keep going back to all this false preaching? Let me tell you why.
Amen.
The book of Ephesians.
Yeah.
The book of Ephesians, chapter 4. See, I didn't even know how blind I was. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you grow up in something all your life.
Yeah, right.
And you're told that God looks like this all your life.
Amen.
And people meant well.
Right.
And when you hear me get all fired up and the veins start popping out of my head, it's not because I like hate people. It's not because I'm mad at people. I'm mad at the devil that's behind it.
Amen.
I'm mad at the blindness and the darkness and the drunkenness that takes place because of it.
Amen.
Because I am out there trying to talk to people. And I'm here to tell you that people are lost.
Yeah.
And it frustrates me for their soul that they can't see. And I plead with them. And sometimes I nearly beg them. Please, won't you hear what it is that I'm trying to say, that I'm trying to tell you. And many times they just throw it off. And listen, the worst ones are people that go to other churches.
Amen.
Yes.
I'm talking about churches that would say that they're believing the same thing we believe.
Yes.
Churches that would say that they're preaching the same thing that we're preaching.
Yes.
And the reality of it is that they're not.
Yes.
And the sad thing is that they don't even know it.
That's
yes.
Right.
And I know that sounds so, it sounds so arrogant. It sounds so cocky, but that's not what I'm doing. I'm not trying to be arrogant, cocky, or prideful. I'm trying to tell you the harlot has caused drunkenness, not just in the world, but in the church. How do you know? Oh, and listen to me. I'm not just talking to you about something that I just woke up one day after sleeping in a Holiday Inn Express or something. I read it. I studied it. I spent hours, countless hours, studying modern movements in the modern church. And I'm here to tell you right now, they have taken the ways of the world and, like corporate CEOs, opened up the doors to the church, to the modern ways of doing worldly business, and they have changed the doctrines, they have changed the message from behind the pulpit. Because if you think you're going to build a big old mega church preaching like this preacher's preaching this morning, you got another thing coming. Because I guarantee you at some point in time, somebody's going to get their toes stepped on, somebody's going to get aggravated with the preacher. But it wasn't even his fault, because all he did was try to be a watchman. All he did was try to do what the Lord called him to do. Speak forth my word to my people, that they might know, that they might turn, that they might turn to righteousness and forsake iniquity. That's what the Lord said.
Amen.
You can't preach that in the modern church and build a big old church out of that.
That's right.
But there is a remnant.
Amen.
There's a remnant of people that are looking for a real Jesus. There's a remnant of people that are looking for a real gospel that will change their life, that will minister to their heart. They're not looking for an outward appearance.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. You flip through the channels, boy, you'll see them golden chandeliers and them big old nice golden chairs. And they're like, you send me this much money, and you got it. Boy, look, my friends are like, okay, I'm going to send you some money because I sure would like getting a paycheck. And you understand what I'm saying? They appeal to our greedy nature.
Yeah.
We all got a little bit of that in us. Come on. You know it's true. I mean, if you ain't dealing with greed, you're dealing with something else. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, come on, let's just be real. If we can be real with each other, then we'll get through this thing.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Why do you keep talking about false doctrine, preacher? Because Jesus talked about it. Paul talked about it. Repeatedly they talked about it. If we would have opened up the Bible and read it, we would have been better prepared. I'm just telling you, we would have. If the preacher would have dared spoken the word of God, we would have been better prepared. When the bridegroom cometh, when he hollers in the midnight hour, hallelujah, we would have had illumination, we would have had oil in our lamp, we would have been prepared for the return of our King.
Amen.
says right here in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, it says that, this is the Apostle Paul talking. Let me just tell you what Jesus would say. Jesus said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. I talked about that last week. Leaven is yeast. In the Bible, not one time is it anything good. I mean, you need it to raise your dough up, you know, to get your bread thick, or whatever you call it, fluffy. I don't know what it does, but you get the point. You need yeast in your dough to make the bread, okay? But it's representative of sin. In the Feast of Unleavened Bread in the book of Leviticus, they couldn't have leaven in their home or yeast in their home for a whole week. Couldn't get anywhere near it. It was representative of the fact that Jesus was going to be unleavened without sin. His sinless body would die in our place. All right. Jesus warned in the New Testament, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. The disciples, now you know, this is interesting. The disciples in the boat, these are the ones that are walking with him now. We're talking about slumber. We're talking about sleepy. We're talking about can't see. The disciples that are walking with Jesus in the boat thought Jesus was mad at them because they didn't bring any bread. When Jesus realizes that they're completely missing the point, he said, I'm talking to you about the false teaching of the Pharisees. Their teaching is like leaven. It's like yeast that spreads through the whole batch of the dough, and it begins to change the very nature of the whole thing. When you begin to change the gospel from what it really is, it doesn't accomplish
right.
Amen.
Come on.
What it is that God desires for the gospel to accomplish.
Amen.
Look at verse 14 of Ephesians. It says that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Now let's just stop right there. Let's stop right there for a second. We're talking about darkness. We're talking about no illumination. We're talking about walking, looking for the bridegroom. We can't find him. He's coming back. And in this scripture right here saying, henceforth, what does that mean? That's all King James English for from this point moving forward. Y'all with me on that? That's easy enough, right? From this point moving forward. He's writing to a church in a city called Ephesus. That means he's writing to Christians. That means that they're doing this. He's saying from this point moving forward, you shouldn't be like children tossed to and fro. He's describing like a boat on a riotous sea that's being tossed. You know how I got to this? Remember I asked the question, can a Christian be lost? Because it said that the God of this world has hidden our gospel from them. It's hidden the gospel from the lost. And so then I asked, okay, well that's the unbelievers, but what about the church? Can they be lost? And I said, yeah, if you ain't got no oil in your lamp, you can be lost.
That's right.
Right? And here, if you're being followed by a false doctrine, then you're like a boat tossing around on a sea. You don't have any GPS. You have no direction that's working. And he said right here, how do you know that he's talking about false doctrine? Carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men. You know what that word, I remember way back when we taught the book of Ephesians, what that word in the Greek is. This is the word in the Greek. Hubio. You know what it's descriptive of? It's descriptive of kind of like a paradise. Sleight of hand. Throwing dice or that little game that they play on the streets. Hey, can you tell me which one it's in?
Yeah.
And they got the little card game?
Shell game.
It's the shell game or the card game, right? You know where the ace is? And they flip it around, you try to win the money? Sleight of hand.
Yeah.
What it's saying is that the enemy, this harlot, this god of this world, that blinds the eyes, that puts asleep, that causes drunkenness, has men that stand behind pulpits that purposely, with a sleight of hand, bring deception.
Yes, they do.
Bring confusion.
Yes.
Causing people to be like a boat lost on the sea, being tossed to and fro, no GPS, no direction, no lamp to their feet, no light to their path. They don't know where to go.
Amen.
In the going back to the parable of Matthew chapter 25, actually let's go back to the Song of Solomon. I don't want to leave her out. I appreciate y'all's patience with me. Not only do I get passionate, I'm long-winded. I'm sorry about that if I messed up your afternoon. I preached, y'all missed the window to get out of here before the rain, so now I got to preach to the rain. In the first dream that we saw, it was a dream. She was excited. She was looking for her love. Amen? But in the next time, it's a nightmare. The first dream, the watchman helped her find him. In the second dream, it's a nightmare. In chapter 5 of the Song of Solomon, it says in verse 2, Song of Solomon chapter 5, verse 2, I sleep, but my heart waketh. It is the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled, for my head is filled with dew and my locks with the drops of the night. He's been away. He's been outside. His hair is filled with moisture. He's ready to come in. He's now coming back for her. He's been away on this journey. She's been waiting, and as he's tarried, she's now in the bed right here. This is her response. I have put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? I've already bathed. I've taken off my outer garment. My feet are clean. I'm in the bed. Why should I get out of the bed and get them dirty? She's fallen. She's in a different kind of bed now. Before, she was in a bed that was longing for his return. She was following after him. She was like a wise virgin waiting for him, longing for his relationship. Now she's fallen asleep. She's in the midst of slumber. She's gotten sleepy. She doesn't want to defile her feet. She doesn't want to get up. In verse 4, my beloved put in his hand by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. In other words, he made a move, and all of a sudden her insides got all tingly. They started jumping. She's like, uh-oh. Now I remember. I remember how much I love him, and I want to find him. All right? So it says right here, I rose up to open to my beloved, and now my hands dropped with myrrh. Before, he had a love that was willing to die, but now all of a sudden she touches the doorknob and she sees her hands dripping with myrrh. Now she has death on her hands, and I'm going to tell you, she opens up the door and he's gone. She opens the door. She missed the moment, the opportunity. She missed the window of opportunity. She was like one of the 5 unwise virgins. She had fallen asleep. She had slumbered. She was in the bed of the flesh. She was wanting to live for herself at that moment in time. And now in the midst of this dream, she opens the door and he's gone. And once again, she takes to the streets and she runs frantically. I'm going to close with this. She finds the watchman again. But this time the watchman doesn't help her find him. This time the watchman beats her, smites her. I got to tell you something. I don't think this is for you because you're the church, amen? You love Jesus. We don't want to be like the 5 of the church. But I got to tell you that the same word of God that will lead and guide you to Jesus is the same word of God that will judge us in the end if we did not heed the call, if we did not heed the word, if we did not submit to the gospel.